Thank you very much. Many people wonder if it's my name, Hans Finzel, where am I from, yes? And you wonder where I'm from, Hans Finzel? From Deutschland, yeah. Actually, I was born and raised in a small little country in the south, and I don't know if any of you have been to my little country in all the years of your travels, but I'm from the small little country, Alabama. Any of y'all here ever been to Alabama before? Are you from Alabama? All right. Okay, born and raised in Huntsville, Alabama, but yes, I am pure German.
Das hier ist mein Sektor.
Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters.
Das Gerät und das Gerät.
Überlebensradar.
Mayday, Mayday. Hello, can you hear us? Can you hear us? Can you... Over. We are sinking. We are sinking.
Hello? This is the German Coast Guard.
We are sinking. We're sinking.
What are you thinking about?
I was born and raised in Huntsville, Alabama. If you know anything about Huntsville, you know it's a city full of Germans. My father used to work for Wernher von Braun, if you've ever heard that name before. Wernher von Braun was a very famous rocket scientist in Germany. Actually, in high school, he wrote a paper on how to put a man on the moon when he was a high school student in Germany before the war. And the Apollo program, all those years later, was modeled after the paper that he wrote in high school. Never underestimate those high school kids and what they might be writing. At the end of the war, the Germans lost the war, by the way, in case you didn't know. And the Russians, the British, the French, and the Americans all wanted to capture these scientists to learn how to build missiles. And Dr. von Braun said, that's my dad and him, my dad getting a commendation during the NASA program. But Dr. von Braun said, let's go get captured by the Americans, and we can go to America and build rockets. And that's exactly what happened. They surrendered to the U.S. Army in Bavaria. They were out of 5,000, I'll try it here in just a second, after 5,000 rocket engineers and scientists, my dad was one of the 100 that was chosen to come to America. And they landed in Fort Bliss, Texas, and then they moved them all to Huntsville, Alabama in 1950, where the George C. Marshall Space Flight Center began. All that to say, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to be the son of one. When I was a kid growing up, I remember John F. Kennedy coming to my hometown, and he had been humiliated by the Cuban Missile Crisis, giving you a little history lesson here. And he was looking for something to inspire the country. Even though I'm speaking today about the top 10 mistakes leaders make, this is going to be very positive and very inspirational. And Wernher von Braun was an amazing visionary. You know, vision is taking people to a place they cannot take themselves. And von Braun was a visionary, and Kennedy was a visionary. And Kennedy came to my hometown. I remember I had this big parade. And von Braun said to Kennedy, if you give us some money, we can put the man on the moon by 1970. I don't know if any of y'all have seen the movie right now going around. Hidden Figures, yeah. It's kind of about part of the space program. It's an excellent movie. Oh, you pastors, you don't go to movies, right? But it was an amazing time to watch the vision of a couple of key leaders and what it took our country through. It was a real inspiring time in our nation's history. The next slide is a picture of my dad years later when he retired. The biggest rocket they ever built was the Saturn V rocket, and that's it laying on its side. Pretty big, isn't it? My dad's the one there on the far left with the circle around his head. That's after they all retired at the end of the Apollo program. Biggest engine ever developed, bigger than the space shuttle. Is it working now?
We'll find out.
So people ask me, Hans, did you want to be a rocket scientist or an engineer? My older brother's an engineer. But no, I actually wanted to be a businessman and make a whole lot of money. That's what I wanted to do. I was a hippie. I was the 1960s. I was a rebel. I did not want to do what my parents did. Maybe some of you can relate to that. So I went away to the university to get away from them and just to do whatever my sinful nature chose to do. Thankfully, four students when I was a freshman at the University of Alabama led me to Christ. They took me on as a semester project. And I was, hard to believe, I was a long hair hippie. And I had beautiful long black hair. And these guys just worked on me for 6 months. I was so wasted on drugs. I was a lost cause. Don't ever give up on people and say they're a lost cause. People are never a lost cause. And they just kept dripping the love of God on me. And I was so flaky. They would invite me to meetings, to Bible study. I'd say, yeah, I'm going to be there. And they'd come to pick me up and I wasn't there. Next time I saw them, they wouldn't say, where were you, Hans? How come you let us down? They'd say, hey, we got another Bible study. Let's go. They led me to Christ. Jesus said, by this shall all men know you're my disciples, if you build beautiful churches in my honor. By this shall all men know you're my disciples, if you write amazing theological books that answer people's questions. No, what did he say? By this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have love. Love is the mark of the Christian. And these four students over 6 months loved me into the kingdom of God, changed my life. Completely changed my life and gave me a purpose. The minute I came to Christ, I knew I was going to spend the rest of my life telling other people this message. A lot of you can relate to that, can't you? Well, I went to a little Bible college called Columbia Bible College in Columbia, South Carolina. You all ever heard of it? It's now Columbia International University in South Carolina. And the guys that led me to Christ gave me this little notebook, a catalog from the college. And on the cover was the seal of the school. To know him and to make him known. I could not believe there was a school and that was the purpose of the university. I said, I'm going there. And so I left the University of Alabama. I went to Columbia and it changed my life. I learned to get to know my Savior at Columbia. That's Shortest Chapel, where I also met my wife there. We've been married for 42 years. I'll show a picture of my family in just a moment. But it was at Columbia that I learned about missions. You see, I didn't know missionaries existed in the modern era. I thought missionaries were like dinosaurs that had once roamed the surface of the planet, but now were obviously extinct. Maybe it's something the Catholics did. But I found out missions is real, and God called me into missions. I love this statement from Henry Martin, the spirit of Christ is the spirit of missions. And the nearer we get to him, the more intensely missionary we will become. We moved to Europe and we became missionaries and trained leaders in Eastern Europe. That's a picture of my wife and I and our four children. That's not a recent shot, you can tell. That was our missionary prayer card a long time ago. And God called us to reach out to Eastern Europe. And this is where leadership became important to me because we worked behind the Iron Curtain during the days of communism, during the Iron Curtain, the Berlin Wall. And we were training pastors and Christian leaders all over Eastern Europe. The reason we were located in Vienna is it was the easternmost outpost of Western civilization. And all the missionaries that work in Eastern Europe and all the spies that worked in Eastern Europe lived in Vienna. And it was a tremendous thing we did for 10 years to train the persecuted leaders of the church all over Eastern Europe. Poland, Romania, Hungary, Bulgaria, Russia, East Germany. And who would have thought, if you'll hit the next slide, that the Berlin Wall would come down. I was there the day the wall came down. I call it history's greatest prison break. It was amazing. For me, it was amazing for two reasons. My parents were from the part of Germany that was East Germany, and they were brokenhearted about what the communists had done to their country. And when this happened, for me, it was personal because of my family, but it was also spiritual. Because all those people who were living in communist persecution were now free. And it was so beautiful to see all the leaders that we had trained now had permission to start Bible schools and seminaries, and they just floated up to the top. What a great prison break. Next slide. After that experience, I spent 20 years running a ministry that is today called World Venture, which works in 75 countries of the world. The next slide shows my family. That little group of four kids became married and grandkids. That's my wife on the left, and we have our seventh grandchild will be born in South Africa on Thursday, Lord willing, this coming Thursday. And my wife and I leave for South Africa Thursday. Yeah, so we're pretty excited how God has blessed us. I love leadership. I love good leadership. This is a picture of me wandering through a little African village, Mali, West Africa. I love missions, and I love the fact that I spent my whole career traveling the planet and seeing what God is doing in missions around the world. Today's not a missions talk, today's a leadership talk. But why do you suppose these little kids are following me through the village? Because I'm a great leader? No, because I'm a big white man. And there is no electricity, there are no televisions, there are no smartphones, there's nothing to do in this little village. They are following me out of pure curiosity. Perhaps he's got candy in his pocket. If you think you're a leader and nobody's following you, you're only taking a walk. That's all I was doing. I love good leadership. Next slide. My wife and I started a ministry called HD Leaders when I left World Venture 4 years ago. What do you suppose HD stands for? Heavy duty? High definition? No, it's Hans and Donna. And if you want to learn more about our ministry, you can go there. I want to talk to you about the listening guide. One of you purchased this guide at the table. You said, man, that looks like more than 3 hours of material. Well, yeah, we're not going to go through the whole listening guide. We're only going to hopefully hit 4 of the top 10 mistakes leaders make today. But if you are in the guide, if you'll go to page number 5, and those of you at the remote sites, you can also get this on Kindle if you want to download it. Of course, the problem with Kindle is you can't write in a Kindle book. But a lot of you have the guide, and I want to start by looking at on page 5. So there, when I studied leadership at Fuller years later, I found that there were over 350 definitions of leadership. It can be a really confusing topic. If I were to ask you, if we had the time, I'd say, what is the key to being an effective leader? What is the key to the kind of leader that you would respect and follow? I bet you we would get as many answers as there are people in this room. There is no key. There is no one secret to great leadership. The definition I like the best is the word influence. Leadership is influence. And anytime you influence anybody, you are leading them, right? If you're a parent, if you're a mom or a dad or a teacher, or anybody, you're influencing people, you are leading them. So a lot of people will say to me, well, Hans, I'm not really a leader. You might be a leader and you don't even realize how many people you influence, for good or for bad. History is the story of leadership, good and bad. So I want to start by giving you 4 leadership observations. If you do what comes natural, you'll be a poor leader. Why do you suppose I'd say that? And see, this is a problem. I have found there are more bad leaders than good leaders out there. And one of the reasons is they do what comes natural. What comes natural to the human spirit? By the way, I will be asking questions, even though there are remote sites. I'm going to have an interaction with you. So feel free, if I ask you a question, to shout out an answer, okay? That's right. Focusing on yourself. We, by nature, are selfish people. We, by nature, are sinful people. So what is it that discourages us so much today in America about so much of the leaders we see in government and business? It's like self-serving. If you do what comes natural, you will be a poor leader. Number 2, people are confused about how to be a great leader because of poor role models. We lead as we were led, right? When I was in high school, I had my first job and I worked for a guy named Charlie. And Charlie's philosophy was, Hans, we only work when the boss is around. And when he's not around, we just goof off in the warehouse and play cards. That was my first boss. Now, I'm German, and my parents raised me different than that. So I would work even when the boss wasn't around. What do you suppose Charlie thought about me? Charlie didn't like me because I was, like, working when the boss wasn't around. We lead as we were led. And some of you have some real poor leadership habits because you're just imitating what your leaders did to you. Number three, there seem to be more bad leaders than good leaders. Do you ever look at people in leadership and say, how in the world did they get there? You scratch your head and say, why are they the leader of that? Whatever, you fill in the blank. And finally, churches and ministries need more great leaders. Would you agree to that?
Sure.
And that's my passion today, to help church and ministry leaders do a better job of their leadership, because you impact so many people. And if I can help you improve your game a little bit, you know how much ripple effect that'll have in the kingdom of God around the world? The better you lead, the better our strategies and our objectives will actually come to fruition. We all know the results of bad leadership. Just take a look at this slide and let it absorb upon you for a moment. The truth of this slide, it's what I call the trickle-down effect of leadership. If you have bad leaders at the top, it just seems like it trickles down, doesn't it? Okay, some of you are finally get it. It's okay to laugh. It's okay. I talk to a lot of people who suffer under poor leadership, and this is just how they feel. And great leadership is the same. So here's a question for you. Have you ever worked for a terrible boss? Raise your hand if you've worked for a terrible boss. I always get that response. 90% of you, if not more, raised your hand. If so, what made them so terrible? I'd like to hear a couple of answers from you. What made them so terrible? What's that? All right, publicly shaming someone. It's their way or the highway.
Do as I say, not as I do.
Do as I say, not as I do. Anything else? Okay, using people like tools, like ants, instead of like real people. The one I hear a lot is they don't listen. That's one of the biggest complaints I hear. The story that led to this book, Top 10 Mistakes Leaders Make, if you've read the book, or in the introduction I talk about suffering under a terrible boss, a wonderful man of God, a great visionary that God used mightily, but humanly speaking, he was a horrible boss, dictator, control freak. Blessed are the control freaks, for they shall inhabit the earth. Man, he was exhibit A. And so I became the president of our ministry years later, and I said, Lord, I don't want to be that kind of leader that frustrates people. You can be a person that stands in the way of people's dreams because of your leadership. Or you can be the kind of leader that empowers people. As Zig Ziglar always used to say, if you help people get what they want, you will get what you want. I am honored to be speaking in the room with Zig where he was. I just feel that energy. If you help people get what they want, you will get what you want. And that's a different kind of leadership. Well, Romans 12:8 says that it's the various gifts that God has given the church. Romans 12:8 says, if it is to encourage, give them encourage. If it is giving, give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If you have the responsibility of leadership, work at it, study it, improve it, always be bettering your game. So I want to applaud you for being here today. And those of you at the remote sites, you are improving your leadership by being here. And that's exactly what Romans 12:8 tells us. So I wrote the book, and of course people ask me all the time, have you made all these mistakes, these 10 mistakes? Are you kidding me? I've made hundreds of mistakes, and I just had room for the top 10 in the book. And we're only going to cover a few of my favorite this morning. But those of you who would like to continue the study beyond this morning, I would encourage you to get the workbook and get the book and have a study group and have a lunch or a periodic meeting. And you can fill the blanks in yourself for the chapters that I don't cover. I'm a huge fan of Peter Drucker, not only because he was pure German, but because he's one of the greatest management gurus of all time. Peter Drucker said, we spend a lot of time teaching leaders what to do. We don't spend enough time teaching leaders what to stop. Half the leaders I've met don't need to learn what to do. They need to learn what to stop. Stop it. Sometimes we have blind spots. And 95% of our leadership is very effective, but we have this 5% blind spot that can neutralize our entire effectiveness. Because you know what? That's all that people see. That annoying habit. That's why I'm a big fan of emotional intelligence, EQ. And EQ is more important than IQ. EQ, emotional intelligence, is allowing people to give you feedback about your leadership and coming to grips with those blind spots and doing something about it. Leadership can be very dangerous.
This man right here is my great-grandfather. He's the first cat herder in our family.
Herding cats. Don't let anybody tell you it's easy.
Anybody can herd cattle, holding together 10,000 half-wild short hairs, well, that's another thing altogether.
Being a cat herder is probably about the toughest thing I think I've ever done.
I got this one this morning, right here, and if you look at his face, it's just ripped to shreds, you know?
You see the movies, you hear the stories, I'm living a dream. Not everyone can do what we do.
I wouldn't do nothing else.
It ain't an easy job, but when you bring a herd into town and you ain't lost a one of them, ain't a feeling like it in the world.
How many of you feel that's just what you do, right? Herding cats. Leadership is dangerous. Leadership can be challenging. How many of you gotten scratched on your face by your people? Boy, I sure have. I've gotten a lot of scratches on my face. I love Moses. The book I have out there, the Top 10 Leadership Commandments, is all about the leadership of Moses, 10 of the enduring principles of leadership from his life. In the darkest hour of my leadership, leading World Venture, and I had some dark hours, I was opposed, resisted, and misunderstood. And I was just started studying Moses, and I was just captivated by his endurance. Did anybody have a more difficult leadership challenge in the history of the planet and the Bible than Moses? And he didn't quit. He was a great, great leader. But leadership can be dangerous. So let's talk about the number one mistake leaders make. The number one mistake, and it's the first chapter in the book, is what I call the top-down attitude. Now, the whole book, you don't go one is the worst and 10 is the least of the worst. But the number one mistake is what I think the worst mistake leaders make. And this is on page 6 of the listening guide, and it trickles down to a lot of other things. The top-down attitude. What is it? Well, it's an attitude that says, I'm on the top because I'm the smartest. I'm the boss, so you serve me. I'm the leader, so I'm going to control everything. I make all the big decisions. That's a top-down attitude. Did you ever play King of the Mountain when you were a little boy or a little girl? King of the Mountain is still being played today after all these years. Bunch of kids, there's a little hill, and whoever gets on top of the hill and can push the other kids down, they are what's called the King of the Mountain. And top-down leaders love to play King of the Mountain, and they say, because I'm on top, I'm the most important. And therefore, everybody serves me. And it results in these things: abuse of authority, dictatorship in decision-making, dirty delegation, lack of listening, a controlling management style, and an egocentric leadership, which means it's all about me. It's not about we. It's about me. That's the top-down attitude. Now, the crazy thing is how prevalent this attitude is in the world. Have you noticed that? It's the most common. It's traditional. It's historical. It's ingrained, and it's global. I don't know how many of you spend a lot of time overseas in other countries. Harold, I know you do. And I've noticed in Asia, the top-down attitude is worse than it is here. Why do you suppose that is? It's because of the Asian cultures had a lot of kings, had a lot of dictators. And then you go to Africa. Oh, my goodness. Have you spent time in Africa? It's amazing how much. I remember going to another little village in Africa, and the first thing that happens when I come to visit a village is they want to take me to meet the chief. I don't maybe necessarily want to meet the chief, but that's the most important person in the village. In a tribal culture, the chief, and the chief controls everything. That's the top-down attitude, and that's why globally it's very ingrained in so many cultures and very tough to change. But can you change it? Yes. The alternative is what I call servant leadership. The alternative to top-down leadership is servant leadership. My two favorite passages about servant leadership are John 13 and Philippians 2. Really the exact same theme. If you have your Bibles, if you'll turn them on and go to John chapter 13. I'm listening to the rustling of the pages and I'm not hearing it. So I'm thinking probably John chapter 13, the greatest teaching on servant leadership. And we don't have time to exegete verse by verse, but I just want to look at a couple of things in John chapter 13. It was just before the Passover festival. That's John 13, 1. Jesus knew the hour had come for him to leave the world. Having loved his own were in the world, he loved them to the end. He showed them now how utterly and completely he loved them that night before he was betrayed. There's a great teaching in this passage on the opposite of top-down leadership. If anybody in history had the right to be a dictator, who was it? Our Lord Jesus Christ. But he was not a dictator in his leadership. It says the evening meal was in progress. The devil had already prompted Judas to betray him. And here's what Jesus knew. He knew he was the most important person in the room. He knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and that he was returning to God. In other words, everything was in his control. The crucifixion was not an accident. It was not his plan gone amok. No, it was under his control. And knowing that he himself is God, knowing that, he got up from the meal, took the towel, took the basin. And if you can imagine being there that night, you see, the person that was not there that normally would be there was the servant that washed the feet. I've been in a lot of secret meetings during my days of working in communist Romania and East Germany. And one thing we did when we had our secret meetings with the windows closed and only trusted people were allowed to come to these secret meetings by invitation, by word of mouth. No posters put up anywhere, believe me. And so no unessential people would be in our meetings. Same spirit was going on the night of the Passover. Mobs were looking for them. They had a secret meeting. There was no servant. And so nobody washed their feet. So Jesus got up from the meal and he took the basin. And I think there might have been a moment of time where people were thinking, who's he going to give the basin to do the dirty work? Right? But he didn't. By the way, who would have they thought the probably should do the dirty work? Judas. They all knew Judas was the low man on the totem pole. Well, he didn't give the basin to someone else. He started to wash the first disciples' feet. If you were there that night and you saw your Lord begin to wash the disciples' feet, that moment, how would you feel? You know he's coming to you. How would you feel? Uncomfortable? Ashamed? Unworthy? Humiliated? Like Peter? Peter's the only one that spoke up and said, no way, Lord. But you know what else? I would have thought to myself, oh, I lost the opportunity to take the initiative. You know, that's what servant leadership is. It's doing the work, the dirty work, without being asked. It's taking the initiative. And he washed all their feet. And then it says in verse 13, you call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, that's what I am. Now I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet. You also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I've done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Servant leadership. Servant leadership is putting others first. In Philippians chapter 2, 3, and 4, we find the exact same principle. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value others above yourselves. You see, it's an attitude. To me, servant leadership is an attitude. And it's an attitude where you value others actually above yourself. Isn't that radical? If you're the boss, it's so easy to get that turned around and think I'm the most valuable because I'm the pastor. I'm the senior pastor, or I'm the president, or I'm the owner of the company. It's so easy to get turned around and thinking I'm the most valuable. That's why I'm the leader. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interest of others. Here's my definition of servant leadership. When the leader cares more about the good of the team than his or her own enrichment, that's servant leadership. When the leader cares more about the good of the team than his or her own enrichment. The alternative to top-down leadership is servant leadership. And you know, Peter was there that night. Peter was one of the ones who had his feet washed. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 through 3, we see that he got the lesson from the Last Supper. He got it. Because when he had a chance to write his book, he says, to the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed, be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to, not pursuing dishonest gain. Doesn't that sound like a lot of leaders we see out there in our culture? But eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. The world looks at leadership like this. I'm on the top of the pyramid. They're my other leaders. And then the people who serve us. That's the world's view of leadership. Did you know we live in an upside down kingdom? Everything about the Christian faith and the Word of God is upside down from what the world believes and thinks and teaches. So this is the way, to me, servant leadership. I'm actually on the bottom. And then there's the other leaders, and then the people we serve. That's servant leadership. It's a very different kind of leadership. Now, there's a lot of misunderstandings about servant leadership I've seen. And you can look at this and say, well, that means I'm going to have to carry a pretty heavy load and I've got to carry everybody on my back. I'm not saying that. I was in China about a year ago and I was teaching on servant leadership to the house church movement there. And believe me, that is a tough challenge. Everything in China is top down. I mean, they've had 50, 60 years of communist dictatorship, and before that they had kings, and it's all top down. And I'm teaching on servant leadership, and I'm trying to get them to embrace this, and they say, Hans, it just doesn't work in our culture. And I said, well, what do you think servant leadership is not? And they helped me come up with this list of what I like to say servant leadership is not. Because this is kind of where they're suffering. You let everyone else set your agenda. You do all the dirty work. You serve everyone's requests. You work 24/7 for the requests of others. You don't lead strong. This is not servant leadership. Let me give you some more. You're a doormat. You let others walk all over you. Others take advantage of you. You're the victim of the tyranny of the urgent. You see, in the Chinese house church movement, this is exactly what the congregation expects of their pastor. And that's not servant leadership. That's slave leadership. It's not servant leadership, it's slave leadership. So don't be confused about what servant leadership is and what it is not. It's not these things. And you have to learn to have boundaries. One of the biggest challenges in the house church is they never have a day off. I was talking to one of you beforehand about nowadays most of you pastors don't take Monday as your day off because you have to go to the hospital on visits and you have a lot of follow-up from Sunday, so maybe later in the week you have a day off, hopefully. I'm a big believer in not being a workaholic. I asked these Chinese house church pastors, when do you take a day off? We do not have a day off. Our church expects us always to work. Well, at least you get some good vacation, don't you? Then it was like deer in the headlights. No, we never get vacation. We can't leave our congregation. That's not servant leadership. That's living by the tyranny of the urgent and allowing everybody else to set your agenda. That's not good leadership. And you can look at what our Lord accomplished in 3 years on this earth, and you know he did not allow everybody to dictate his agenda, but yet he was a servant leader. So I like to say, don't carry them on your back. Carry them in your heart. It's really an attitude. It's really an attitude. When the leader cares more about the good of the team than his or her own enrichment. So I want to ask you, before we have our break, a reality check. Does this work in the real world, this servant leadership stuff? I believe it does. I was speaking to a group of executives in Chicago about servant leadership, and they weren't picking up what I was laying down. They got the impression that I was teaching weak leadership. I said, Hans, if we exhibit weakness, we'll be eaten alive in this corporate atmosphere that we're in. So I went back and did some research, and I began to think, does this work out there beyond the church? What do you think? Does it? Are there servant leaders in corporate America? Are there servant leaders in the government and in education? Absolutely. Have you ever heard of Jim Collins, who wrote this great book, Good to Great? Tremendous book. And in this book, he analyzed 1,435 companies to find ones that jumped from being good to being great and sustained it for 15 years. It's like the difference between FedEx versus DHL or Kmart versus Target, you know, the really big giant companies that were the most successful and were great, not just good, and sustained it for 15 years. I found something amazing. He says one of the characteristics of these companies that are great companies with great leadership is they have what's called level 5 leaders. And you'll see on top of page 8 is the chart that shows you the level 5 leaders. And this is amazing. When the level 5 leader is the best kind of leader, okay? Number 1 is the worst. I want to be a level 5 leader. And look at this. This is a secular book. And look at the description. Builds enduring greatness through a paradoxical blend of personal humility and professional will. Wow, I love that. Personal humility and professional will. He goes on to say these people are humble. They listened and they learned constantly. They put the company above their personal goals, and they valued employees first. Level 5 leaders, servant leaders. Servant leadership is the best kind of leadership. I have my new book is coming out, my 10th book, on April 1st. It's called The Top 10 Ways to Be a Great Leader. It's like the opposite of the top 10 mistakes leaders make, the top 10 ways. And I use the letters in the word leadership as an acrostic for what I believe are the 10 essential skills every new leader must master. And guess what the L in leadership stands for? Listen and learn. The two most important words in a leader's vocabulary is to listen and to learn. If you stop listening today, you will stop leading tomorrow. And if you stop learning today, you will definitely stop leading tomorrow. We have to be committed to lifelong learning. And if you're committed to lifelong learning, you know what that says? It says, I have not arrived. I'm not yet fully mature. I'm still on a journey. And that's why I tell every leader I ever meet, never stop learning to be a better leader. And never stop listening to the troops. Sometimes people would come to me and say, Hans, you know, I don't think you listen. And I always thought I was a good listener as a CEO. And I would explore with them, why do you say I'm not a good listener? I said, because you don't do what I tell you to do. I said, okay, now that's not what listening is all about. Listening is allowing people to be heard. And one way you can be sure they were heard is you feed back to them, here's what I heard you say. And then when you're all done, say, thank you. Now, I appreciate your input. I appreciate your advice. But that's not what we're going to do. But thank you. And I find most people just want to be heard. And you don't have to explain to everybody why you're not going to do it their way, but you do need to listen. And if you're a leader that is known as a listener, people will respect you and they will trust you and they will follow you. So the opposite of top-down leadership is what I call servant leadership. So a couple of takeaways from this first chapter. Not abusive authority, but view yourself as servant of all. Not dictatorship, but partners in the process. Not deplorable delegation, and we're actually after the break going to talk about delegation, but because I find deplorable delegation is one of the worst sins of bad leadership, not knowing how to delegate properly. Give them room and freedom to do their job. Not lack of listening, but exercising a Philippians 2 posture. Not controlling, but letting go with affirmation. Not egocentric, but the empowerment of others. That's servant leadership. That's the opposite of top-down leadership. Before we take our break, I want to just give a few minutes for questions. You have some questions related to this very important topic, or maybe not a question, but maybe a comment. And I think we're following the Twitter feed or we're following email questions. So those of you on remote sites, if you have a question, you can submit it in the way that I guess you've been instructed to do. Any questions or comments about this topic? How do you escape the tyranny of the urgent? And the second part was an escape the most contentious. That's not the word you used.
Discontented.
The most discontented of your parishioners, of your people. Well, thank you. That's a tough question. Anybody else have any questions?
Yeah.
He just went right to the toughest one. To answer the first question, you have to learn to set boundaries. That is a great book by Henry Cloud, Boundaries. I highly recommend it. But schedule, boundaries. And I know in today's always-on world, it's hard to set boundaries. People think, if I text you, I expect an answer back. Or if I message you, or if I email you. They say only old people use email anymore, but it's more instant than that. See, email takes too long for the young generation. So yeah, I think you have to set boundaries, and you have to let people know your boundaries. I think it's really important for the pastor to let his congregation know, or her congregation know, you know, these are my boundaries. You know, I love you. I'm your servant. I'm your pastor. But I also have a family. I have a marriage. I have a life. And I have to have boundaries. So schedules are probably the best way, where you say, these are the times when I'm available. This is how I can be available to you. But don't expect me to instantly answer every text and instant message I get from you. So set boundaries. Set a schedule. In terms of those contentious or dissatisfied people, I don't know, some of you could probably answer that question better than I could. You just have to starve them. Don't feed them. Starve them. Okay, other questions? Great question. Anybody have an easier question? Yes.
I don't know if it's easier,
So now the question was, how do you avoid people taking advantage of you? And some personality types, you just kind of allow people to take advantage of you. And again, you have a hard time setting boundaries or being strong, where you will let other people sort of determine your agenda. And again, if you let other people determine your whole agenda, then you're just not going to be in control. I'm a big fan of personality tests, like the DISC test and Strengths Finders and the Myers-Briggs. Those three tests I love because they can help you figure out how your personality plugs into this challenge. And you will learn, okay, I am the kind of personality that, you know, my wife's that way. She's a people person. I'm not, but she is. And so she will be fueled by people, and she will allow people to control her entire day. And then at the end of the day, she'll say, wow, I did not get anything done that I needed to get done. After the break, we're going to talk about people work versus paperwork and the priority of people work. So I'm going to touch on that topic some more. So it is a tough tension, because as pastor, you are supposed to be serving your people. And as leaders, we are supposed to be serving our people. But we cannot allow them to determine our entire schedule and to set our agenda. And so for some of you, that may be some growth. You need to take some growth initiative to expand and grow in that area.